Hey everybody, it's your favorite machine girl, wannabe Jedi, resident Disney geek, and pop culture nerd Caitlin. Today is February 4th, 2017, and it's time for another installment of Machine Girl Pop Culture News. Maybe I should add on a little bit to the title, including calling it Machine Girl Pop Culture and Political News. Let's get started and get some big news out of the way. Last week was kind of depressing as Trump banned immigrants and refugees, including those from seven Middle Eastern countries. Ironically enough, the seven Middle Eastern countries they were banned from are countries that have never had a citizen try to commit a terrorist attack in the United States, and also do not have Trump hotels. I'm not sure if that played a decision, but whatever. Anyway, breaking news, a federal judge in Seattle ruled temporarily that the Trump ban cannot stand. In fact, it's been temporarily halted, which is awesome. Homeland Security is also looking into overturning Trump's decision to revoke like 60,000 visas from immigrants who had already been heavily vetted. This is major news, and even though it's only a temporary thing, I think we should celebrate it as a big win. Look at this. This ban is not okay. Our country is majorly divided, and it's only going to get divided in the days to come as we find ourselves facing up against each other on anything topic. But look at what it's doing. It's bringing people of all races, creeds, religions, anything together to fight for others. I mean, people are going to the airports and protesting. One guy on The Daily Show with Trevor Noah, I think that's his name, talked about how he was at the airport and people were coming up to him and thanking him for being Muslim. And he was in awe because he saw white women, women like me and other women, taking scarves and turning them into hijabs. Those women probably years ago might have been calling the hijabs oppressive articles of clothing, okay? It's amazing. Trump is a decisive man, he's a hateful man, he's an angry man, and yet because of him, thousands of people are coming together like never before. So even though I think we might have made a mistake in making him president, I still see the good that's coming about and people standing up and fighting for what they believe in. So that is good news. It's temporary, but let's hope more people stand up and fight for what's right and what's good. And remember that it doesn't matter who you are or where you're from or what you believe in. I believe in love because I'm Christian and the Bible says to love everybody. So I'm going to love everyone in the world. I don't care who you are. So for me, this is awesome news because I'm seeing it coming to life every time I turn on the news, which I might need to stop watching because sometimes the news is still getting me majorly depressed. Anyway, enough with political news. Let's get on to what's happening, and let's turn to the world of sports, because tomorrow is February 5th, and for football fans, it is the highlight of the football calendar. Tomorrow night is the Super Bowl! That's right, tomorrow night, the New England Patriots take on the Atlanta Falcons to see which football team is the best this season in America. And in case you're wondering who I'm rooting for, two words, go Falcons! I am cheering for the Atlanta Falcons, and I really, 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 really insanely want them to win. And it has nothing to do with Tom Brady being a total jerk and being friends and da da da. No, I just really want the Falcons to win. I think they're the better team. I personally think Brady and the New England Patriots get a lot of stuff handed to him simply because he's Tom Brady of the New England Patriots. So please, Falcons, play your best tomorrow night and pound those Patriots into the ground. I said Falcons, right? I'm kind of hyper, so good luck, Falcons. I really, 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 really hope you win the Super Bowl. It'd be so awesome if you did. Also, for those of you who like me, also like a dose of cuteness with their hardcore sports, or just want something soft, fluffy, and cuddly, tomorrow the Animal Planet returns at 3 p.m. with its much-loved cuteness extravaganza, the Puppy Bowl. I will also be tuning in to see the Puppy Bowl because I just love it. It's puppies and kitties, and sometimes there's goats and hamsters, and it's just a whole pile of cute loveliness overload, okay? Who doesn't like baby animals? It's so cute, and the best part is they're all rescues who afterwards were adopted. This is a great event, not just because it's cute and fluffy and totally family-friendly, but because it's a great message about the importance of getting out there and adopting instead of buying. So, Puppy Bowl is at 3 p.m. on Animal Planet. The Super Bowl looks like it's going to start at 6:30 p.m. on Fox. It's a sports Sunday, So if you're going to go out and party for the Super Bowl, remember, if you're going to drink, drink responsibly and don't drive. And must not forget, we all have to go back to work on Monday. So yeah, let's be responsible about it. I don't think most employees are happy when their employers are happy when their employees call in after Super Bowl Sunday. See, maybe they should tell people that it might be a smart idea to make Super Bowl Monday, like move the Super Bowl to maybe Saturday, because then people wouldn't be calling in sick on Mondays. I lucked out. I do have to work on Monday, but I don't have to work till 1 p.m., so I get to sleep in just a little bit, but I'm really excited. And, of course, Super Bowl commercials. I'm really excited to see the Anheuser-Busch one. I saw a little of it. I'm really excited. So, Super Bowl tomorrow. Let's get hyped and go, Falcons, go! Anyway, let's get on to non-sports and non-political news. Let's head down to the wonderful world of Disney. Disney announced that it's closing two fan favorite locations at Hollywood Studios. Starring Roles, a restaurant, recently closed, and there's no word on what will replace what has been a fan favorite. At the renamed Disney Springs, something even more, in my opinion, sad is happening. After many years, Disney is closing down the interactive, multi-story, massive arcade Disney Quest. The last day for operations at Disney Quest is July 3rd, and it will be replaced with an NBA experience-themed thing with, like, shops and stuff like that. I, for one, am kind of sad. I've never been to Disney World, but I keep saying that. But Disney Quest is something that really sounded awesome. Disney Quest was like this multi-level, huge arcade, including an area where you could design, build, and even ride your own virtual roller coaster. It was a great family thing. It was the perfect place to go during the wet Florida days to go hang out. So it's kind of sad to see this fan favorite closing. And replacing it with something that, in my mind, while NBA is kind of cool, I thought they already tried something similar and it didn't exactly work out. So only time will tell if the NBA experience will enjoy the same level of success as Disney Quest. And speaking of events happening at Disney World, March 1st marks the beginning of Epcot's International Flower and Garden Show, which goes to, I think, like May or June or something. So if you're heading down to Disney World and you love plants, go check it out. They have these really cool topiaries, and it's going to be beautiful. And if you're going to be go down there again, definitely go and check it out twice. They do a second or third, they do like multiple plantings throughout the festival, and with each planting, the area only gets more beautiful. I love seeing the pictures. I love seeing the videos from Epcot's Flower and Garden Show. It's so cool. So go check it out if you're going to be down there starting in March. So, on to Star Wars. This is going to be a short video. Why? Because, again, no Star Wars Rebels. Star Wars Rebels is not coming back till the 18th with Legacy of Mandalore. Sad for me, and probably sad for you, but that's okay because that's just getting us hyped for Legacy of Mandalore, which is awesome. And to fill a void, we do have the return of the Star Wars show, which is so cool. I love it. And Pablo Hidalgo went to the set of Rogue One to learn some scenes, and he learned a secret about why there are seemingly no handrails in Star Wars. It's because George Lucas said, in the Star Wars universe, there's no such thing as health and safety rules. That explains why on the bridges of Star Destroyers, in like the little energy fields of like a Naboo palace or something like that, there are no handrails, which explains why it's so easy to see someone go flying off and go, oh, bye-bye. So, yeah, no handrails because there's no such thing as safety regulations, which is kind of interesting. Anyway, on to some big news. While Rebels is off, that doesn't mean people are stopping the Star Wars train. Mark Hamill made headlines as he came to the defense of not just the prequels, but Jake Lloyd. Yeah, Luke Skywalker himself is kind of upset with people bashing the Phantom Menace, Attack of the Clones, and Revenge of the Sith. One of the things he said to an interview with New York Magazine was, I can't believe some of the things they wrote about the prequels. You know, I mean, really, beyond, I didn't like you ruined my childhood. I'm still angry about the way they treated Jake Lloyd, who played young Anakin Skywalker. He was only 10 years old, that boy, and he did exactly what George wanted him to do. Believe me, I understand clunky dialogue. I am totally with Mark Hamill on this. You know, I understand the prequels aren't everybody's favorite Star Wars movies. They're not exactly mine, but I don't hate them. Okay, let's take a case in point. One, I was introduced to Star Wars when I was in elementary school via TV, okay? I saw New Hope on like ABC or Fox. So I wasn't introduced to it like in a traditional manner. So I saw them on TV and I was like, it was really cool. The prequels are the first actual Star Wars movies that I kind of were like, hey, this is awesome. This is neat. Now that I'm older and I rewatch them, I see the weak points. For me, the thing that bothers me the most is the overuse of CGI. But again, this is something understandable. When I go back and I watch the documentary about the making of Phantom Menace, you hear George Lucas mention at one point how whatever they do in Phantom Menace, other movies and other TV shows are going to want to copy this. So in a way, the Star Wars series, especially the Skywalker Legacy movies, have always kind of been an experimentation in filmmaking. And sometimes experiments don't always work. So I understand where Mark Hamill is coming from. I understand where those of you who don't like the prequels are coming from. For me, I like the prequels. And ever since I started watching Clone Wars, I actually enjoyed the prequels more. So I understand if you don't like the prequels, but like Mark Hamill said, I don't really understand where you guys are just like bashing them, especially poor Jake Lloyd. I mean, hasn't he kind of been through enough? I mean, it's kind of a hard thing to go and to be like, oh, you played this evil guy and it's... Still, I understand where you're coming from bashing the prequels, but I personally like them. I think they're awesome, and it only has a little bit to do that two of my favorite Jedi characters are in them. So, yeah. So that's really cool. Mark Hamill came out and defended it. He also revealed in that same interview that he wasn't sure he was actually going to come back and do Luke Skywalker for the new movies. And what has been termed, now you've heard me say it, the Skywalker Legacy. That is what they are calling him now. The episodes are the Skywalker Legacy, which kind of makes sense. He says he wasn't sure if he was going to come back and play Luke Skywalker, but then he heard Harrison Ford sign on to reprise his role as Han Solo. And he admitted that that's when he signed on because he knew if he didn't sign on to do them, people would be outside with pitchforks and flaming torches, treating him like he was the bad guy from Frankenstein. So thankfully, we have our Luke Skywalker, which is awesome, going into Episode 8, The Last Jedi, which I did not notice this. At first, when I first saw the teaser poster, I was more freaking out over the fact that Episode 7 and Episode 8 formed a sentence, The Force Awakens, The Last Jedi. I was, like, totally not even paying attention to it until I saw it on Twitter that the outline of the Star Wars logo and The Last Jedi, they're in red! Which, if you're a Star Wars fan and you hear red, you automatically go, ooh, Sith! Yeah. And I didn't even realize it. I didn't stop to think about it. As you can see, one of the reasons is on the wall behind me. I have Star Wars posters from, like, over there. And they go all the way around to over there. And they're probably going to spread over there. So, but I didn't really pay attention to it because on my Star Wars posters, the Star Wars is pretty much the same color. On, like, the older ones, it's, like, black and white and gold. On the prequels, it's pretty much white with gold, and then it's yellow and white, and then I don't even have the one for Rogue One. So it's kind of like, oh, okay. So I didn't even notice the red at first until I saw it, and then they went like, oh, by the way, let's remember that when Revenge of the Sith and Return of the Jedi, those titles were in red too. I went, oh, shnikes. And why? Because in Revenge of the Sith and Return of the Jedi, that's when a Skywalker died. Well, technically, I don't really count Anakin Skywalker dying in Revenge of the Sith, because technically he wasn't dead. Darth Vader just kind of took over. But as Obi-Wan said, he was dead from a certain point of view, which still annoys the heck out of me. Okay, it's a certain point of view. It's not lying, but it's still lying, okay? It's lying by omission. I think that's what you call it. Anyway, so... Does the red title of The Last Jedi mean another Skywalker is going to die? I'm like, no! Please, especially no, don't kill off a Skywalker. But let's jump off that speculation train and jump onto another one. A fan theory has taken the internet by storm about what exactly The Last Jedi could possibly mean. And this one caught my attention and had me going, what the heck are people thinking? It's a cool fan theory. I just don't agree with it. This fan theory, once it loads on my tablet, I found on moviegrub.com, and it states, Star Wars 8 fan theory claims Snoke is the last Jedi. For those of you who are going, who the heck is Snoke? Snoke is Supreme Leader Snoke of the First Order. Basically, he's Hux's and Kylo Ren's boss. He's the one who kind of stole Kylo Ren from his family. Anyway, so this theory is claiming that Supreme Leader Snoke, who has like a giant hole in the middle of his head, is apparently the last Jedi. And I'm trying to, here it is. According to Movie Rub, the theory showed up recently on the Fan Theories Reddit page and was put forward by the user who goes by the name of Anakin Kardashian. Might want to change the name, just the last step. Keep the Anakin, that's cool. There again, given that Luke Skywalker was referred to in the opening crawl of Star Wars, The Force Awakens, as the last Jedi, and Snoke called him that during a conversation he had with Kylo Ren, it has been assumed by everyone, including me, that Luke is the last Jedi that they're talking about. But this new fan theory states that this is the fan theory in Anakin Kardashian's own world. It was pretty cool how we saw Jedi in Rogue One. But was there also a strategic reason? What if we are supposed to get in the mindset that the Jedi Order is very, very ancient? Now, anyone who's read the Legends books, the old Star Wars expanded universe, knows that the Jedi Order is very, very, very ancient. In fact, in Legends, the Jedi actually came from a planet called Tython and actually were not simply light or dark. They had to walk a very thin line between lightness and darkness. And it's actually very cool. I love that ancient theory. Anyway, back to Anakin Kardashian, who continues. In one of the most recent Star Wars novels, Palpatine sends someone to Jakku to uncover an ancient secret. In The Force Awakens, we see that Luke is looking for the original Jedi Temple. What's with this sudden obsession with Jedi history? In The Force Awakens novel, Snoke reveals that he is very old, but we don't know how ancient he is. Could he be older than Yoda, who at the time of the Jedi Order's collapse at the end of the Clone Wars was actually the Grand Master of the Jedi Order? Basically, he was running the thing. And we all know that at that point, Yoda was about 800 years old. Kylo Ren, he also goes on to say, Kylo Ren's lightsaber is confirmed to be an ancient version of the lightsaber. So not the lightsabers we are used to seeing. It is an ancient lightsaber. But where did he get it? Snoke. Now keep in mind the title of Episode 8, The Last Jedi. What if we are learning about early Jedi because we are going to find out how different the ancient Jedi Order is? What if what we know as Jedi are not really Jedi after all? Well, then I might have to change it because I've always been operating under the assumption that those aren't the Jedi. What if Snoke is the last Jedi in its original form? It makes sense that we are learning about early Jedi. It makes sense that Kylo Ren has the ancient version of the weapon. It makes sense that Luke went to look for the original Jedi Temple in order to learn about Snoke. Now, this theory has really kind of taken the internet by storm because of the fact that it is true. All of a sudden, in these new movies, we are seeing more of an interest in learning about the mythos, the history of the Jedi Order, and what exactly everything is. I mean, when you watch Rogue One, you see non-Jedi people, like Jen and her mother, expressing a devotion to the Force as if it is their faith. And they're not Jedi. In fact, Jen wears a kyber crystal around her neck that her mother gives to her. Just like I wear a cross around my neck to symbolize my faith. Was that Jen's family way of symbolizing where their faith lies? And of course you have Chimwe Itwin, who is a monk. He is a protector of the wills, I think that's what it's called. He's basically guarding the Jedi, what remains of the Jedi Temple on Jedi, Will's Temple or whatever. And he's a monk, and he's not Force sensitive, but he's devoted to the Force. Remember, one of his favorite lines is, "I am one with the Force is with me." And he says that a lot. So it's very interesting that maybe in The Last Jedi, we're going to learn more. And maybe this will change our perspective if we learn more about what the ancient Jedi were really like, about what the Order was in the prequels. And maybe it might hint as to what, maybe we might learn as to what made the Jedi Order change into what we saw in the prequels, and maybe that will help explain why it was so easy for Palpatine to overtake it and destroy it at the end of the Clone Wars. While I'm not a big fan of this theory, it is interesting, and I would actually like to learn more about the new Ancient History of the Jedi Order because I think it's cool and awesome. And I'm a history buff, so it'd be really awesome to learn about more about the history of the Jedi. So it's really exciting. Anyway, that's enough for Star Wars. Let's wrap things up with my new guilt. Well, it's not a guilt new. It's still a guilty pleasure. Shadowhunters! Okay, this past Monday continued the heart-wrenching, emotional, overloaded episode that started out in Day of Wrath. Dust and Shadows. Dust and Shadows was really just stood up entitled, hug your mom, kiss your mom, thank your mom, tell your mom you love her. Why? Because, in Day of the Wrath, Jocelyn is killed by a demon-possessed Alec, which means we have Alec who is dealing with his guilt and to the point where he leaves Institute because he simply can't face Clary. Clary is insanely mourning the death of her mother, but refuses to show it and even tells Jace she's going to find a way to bring their mother back. Which doesn't work out as good, but in the midst of it, Jace and Clary discover that Clary has this amazing power to create new ruins. Not sure exactly what it is, but it was kind of cool seeing, spoiler alert, Clary shoot sunlight out of her hand. And Jace, of course, combining the overprotectiveness of a brother with the overprotectiveness of a lover, tells Clary that they shouldn't tell anybody about that at that moment, because he doesn't want Clary taken away from him. And let's remember, Jace himself now knows that Valentine experimented on him. What if the Clave learning of Clary's new powers assumes Valentine experimented on Clary? Doesn't sound good for either Jace or Clary. Anyway, as for Izzy, Mangus helps Alec deal with his issues, Izzy is finding herself in the faceplant of a new issue. Dealing with her not healing wound on her shoulder, Izzy learns that Elder Tree is sending a bunch of Shadowhunters to go visit the Iron Sisters. Just who are the Iron Sisters? They're a bunch of kick-butt female warriors who Izzy wanted to be a part of when she grew up until she learned that Iron Sisters can't have boyfriends. That's right, they're kind of like the nuns of the Shadowhunter universe. Poor Izzy. But Elder Tree says that because of the wound on her shoulder, Izzy can't go. But Elder Tree is willing to help Izzy by giving her a little bit of a demon powder called Yen Fen. Yeah, I hope I got that right. Yep, Yen Fen. Now, this is getting interesting, especially if you're a Shadowhunter like me. Let me break it down for you, for those of you who might not have read the Shadowhunter books. Yen Fen makes its appearance in the Infernal Devices trilogy, which kind of serves as a prequel to the Mortal Instruments. In that trilogy, we are introduced to the Shadowhunter Gem, who is half Asian. As a young boy, he was held captive by a demon, and that demon got him addicted to a demon drug called Yen Fen. Yen Fen gives you energy and makes you really, like, hyper and all that stuff, but it comes with a downside. It actually is kind of leeching the life and color out of you. Gem has silver eyes and silver hair, and he's pretty much dependent on this drug to keep him alive. However, the more often you take the drug, the better it makes you feel, but the quicker your life burns away from you. Now, there's no telling whether Yen Fen will have a similar effect on Izzy in the show, but it is clear that this is a drug. And Izzy is clearly starting to get addicted to it as Elder Tree applies it to her, and she experiences something that I can only describe as euphoric. She even cries a little, and it feels so good. So it's going to be interesting, especially next week's episode, The Iron Sisters, when Izzy and Clary go to see the Iron Sisters, and the Iron Sisters have them do something called the Ritual of Purification. Which I guess is something about rooting out their secrets. It's going to be really interesting to see if Izzy using the Yen Fen will affect her in this trial. Also, I'm really excited for next week's episode, The Iron Sisters, because at long last, our favorite Rolok and Shadowhunter couple are doing it. Mangus and Alec are finally going on their first date! Oh my gosh, I'm so excited! It seems like it took forever in the book series for Mangus and Alec to finally put their differences aside and work things out to finally be a real couple, and I'm hoping it goes faster in the TV series, but I'm so excited that long last Malik and Malik, their couple name, they're getting a first date! I'm so freaking excited! It's like, next to Jason Clary, they're my favorite couple. I really hope things work out for them and go better in the TV show than it did in the book series. I'm super excited. I think they're uber cute, and I love the guy who plays Mangus. I am so sorry. There are instances where I'm watching him. I have to wonder if some of his stuff that he uses for Mangus, if he picked up from Johnny Depp playing Captain Jack Sparrow, because the way he moves, it's like, wow, it's so cool. I am a huge Shadowhunters fan, so I can't wait for Iron Sisters next Monday. If you haven't yet, go check out Shadowhunters on Freeform. It airs every Monday night at 8 p.m., and this season, I promise you won't be disappointed. Anyway, guess what? That's another show, but I do have a bit of news for you. Okay, yes, next week is my birthday, and I'm going to be one year closer to almost over the hill. But actually, this is more news on the employment phone, and it will in the future affect Michigan Girl Pop Culture News. I, shortly, will be leaving to go and spend the summer up on beautiful Mackinac Island, one of Michigan's most beautiful and historical places, working in guest services at the Lakeview Hotel. I'm super excited. It's been my dream for years to go work up on Mackinac Island or even just live there. So I'm really, really happy I'm getting this opportunity to go up there, even if it's just for the summer. But this does mean that Michigan Girl Pop Culture News might take a little bit of a hiatus and simply be replaced with videos of me talking about my experiences or showing you guys the beauty that is Michigan. I'm really excited, and I hope you guys support me as I try out this new adventure, and I really can't wait. I've been dying to have an adventure of my very own, and I'm super excited that I'm finally getting the chance to do this. So, wish me luck. I'm not leaving yet. I don't know when, but I will probably be leaving sometime in April because the busy season starts in May, and right now I might not be home till November. So, it's going to be wonderful spending spring, summer, and part of fall up on the island, so I can't wait. Anyway, thank you guys for watching this edition of Michigan Girl Pop Culture News. Don't forget to like, comment, or subscribe if you like these videos and want me to keep going with the newscast. I will see you guys next Saturday with another edition of Michigan Girl Pop Culture News. But until then, stay safe, stay sane, have tons of fun, enjoy the weather wherever you are. Remember to tell your mom you love her and give her a hug, a really big hug, and do whatever she asks of you for the next week. I'm Caitlin, your favorite Michigan girl, wannabe Jedi, Disney geek, and resident pop culture nerd. I'll talk to you guys next week, and as always, may the force be with you!